Welcome to the 14th meeting of Session 6 of the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee, which is taking place fully online. This follows guidance from the Presiding Officer issued last week to limit the number of people attending Holyrood, and was agreed by the Parliament's corporate body and the Parliamentary Bureau. This is intended to help Parliament play its part in limiting transmission of the virus. First item of business is to take to decide whether to take items 7, 8, 9 and 10 in private. Is the committee content to take these items in private? Thank you. Moving to agenda item number 2, we are taking an evidence session this morning on the committee's inquiry into the use of the made affirmative procedure during the coronavirus pandemic. This is the second of the 2 planned evidence sessions taking place this month, before the committee hears from the Scottish Government in January. Can I welcome to the meeting Professor Stephen Tierney, the Professor of Constitutional Theory from the University of Edinburgh's School of Law, and Sir Jonathan Jones QC, the former Permanent Secretary of the UK Government Legal Department, now with Linklaters LLP. Welcome, gentlemen. And we're very grateful that you're both able to attend virtually today. Can I remind all attendees not to worry about the turning on of their microphones during the session, as these are controlled by parliamentary broadcasting. And with that, I'm going to open the session up to questions, and I'll start the questioning this morning. So before we move to any specific questions on the use of the made affirmative procedure, do witnesses have any initial observations on the use of the procedure during the pandemic? And can I open that up to Sir Jonathan first of all?
Thank you very much, and thank you for inviting me to join the session today. I think all I would say by way of introduction, first of all, just to explain, as you've mentioned, I was Treasury Solicitor and Permanent Secretary of the UK Government Legal Department until last year. So I was in post at the start of the coronavirus pandemic, and I was involved in the early stages of the legal response to that. Since leaving government service later last year, I have continued to follow this issue very closely, in particular the process for legislating about COVID and the extent of parliamentary scrutiny or lack of it. And I've given a lecture about that to the Statute Law Society, among other things. And I'm a member of the advisory panel for the Hansard Society's Delegated Legislation Review, which I think you've heard about from Dr. Ruth Fox. I'm on record as expressing some concerns about aspects of the way that the UK government, at any rate, has legislated for COVID, including the lack of parliamentary scrutiny and the speed with which measures have been introduced. I should make clear that my experience is largely confined to the UK government and the Westminster Parliament. But perhaps I can leave it there for now and we can explore all of that in questioning. Thank you.
Okay, no problem. Thank you very much for that, Sir Jonathan. Professor Tierney.
Yes, good morning, convener. Obviously, we're in unprecedented times and governments are under great strain. But with my other hat on as legal advisor to the House of Lords Constitution Committee, I am aware that the use of this procedure in London is growing. And this is a growing issue for all governments in the United Kingdom. And there is clearly an issue of principle in the made affirmative measures. We appreciate these are challenging times, but the idea that law is made initially without parliamentary scrutiny should cause pause, even in difficult times. As I say, I advise the Westminster Parliament, but I think there's a particular issue for the Scottish Parliament and for any parliament in a multi-level system, because quite often the protagonist can appear to be the central level of government, and there's good reasons for this, as a devolved legislature perhaps looks for more powers or resists interference in its competence. But I think it is important that the Parliament isn't conducting this inquiry and doesn't take its eye off the ball, that a really important task for the Scottish Parliament is controlling the devolved government in the exercise of the powers that it does have. Final observations in general is that from my work in scrutinising legislation over many years, I've come to realise that all governments like powers. They like to get more of them, and they're very clever at expanding the powers they do have, and then very reluctant to relinquish powers once they get them. And they also like, when drafting primary legislation that gives these powers, to subject them to minimum levels of scrutiny. So it seems to me that the job for the Scottish Parliament, as for any parliament, is threefold. First of all, to be very rigorous and indeed reluctant in conceding these powers in the first place. Secondly, checking that they are framed very closely and that their exercise is tightly limited. And then finally, ensuring that mechanisms for scrutiny are very robust. And this is particularly the case with made affirmative procedure. So I think those would be the three guiding principles that I would use for the rest of my evidence.
Okay. Thank you for that, Professor Tierney. I'm going to hand over to Craig Hoy for some questions, but when I was looking through the papers and also looking at the official report from last Tuesday, and also the experience that we've all had over the course of the last, what, near 20 months, would it be fair to say that that the experience has actually shown that governments, whether it's in secondary legislation or otherwise, is it clear? Would you suggest that, or would you agree that that it's proven that governments actually can't legislate for every? Single eventuality, that probably brought along a number of complications and certainly a number of challenges to parliamentarians when we've been attempting to undertake our work. Professor Tierney, do you want to go first?
Yes, there's no doubt about this. And the points I made in my opening remark are points of general principle, because parliaments often have to make themselves unpopular, particularly in these difficult times. The pressure just to concede powers in when urgency is claimed are pressing. And there's no doubt that the Scottish Government, as the UK Government and governments throughout the world, are under intense pressure, and they can't foresee every eventuality. So there's no doubt that that's the case. But that makes it all the more important that when primary legislation is drafted, that the ways that these powers are to be made, the limits on the content of these powers, etc., should be set down clearly. And I think one of the real problems is not simply the made affirmative procedure downstream, but the fact that the primary legislation which created these powers was itself drafted and passed very, very quickly without adequate scrutiny.
Okay. Thank you. So, Jonathan?
Well, I agree with all of that. The risk that I've identified is that, having seen governments necessarily responding at high speed to a genuine emergency, having to do unprecedented things in a hurry, with no opportunity for prior scrutiny, that may have been justified at some stages of the pandemic, right at the beginning, when everybody was working out what to do to respond to the emergency. The risk is that then becomes a habit, because it is sort of convenient for ministers to be able to legislate in that way. And that is the practice that we're continuing to see, certainly in Westminster, that throughout the pandemic, here we are, 18 months and so on into it, admittedly still facing huge challenges, but nonetheless, the legislative response has continued to be, the default position has continued to be, legislate at speed, use the made affirmative procedure or its equivalents, and any scrutiny that happens, if at all, happens only after the event. And that then becomes a habit. And I've suggested it's a bad habit. It may be necessary to act in that way in circumstances of a real emergency, but it should not become the default way of legislating when there is more time and space, or should be more time and space, to consider what the right policy and legal response is. And my fear is that it has become a habit.
Okay, no, thank you for that. Can I just come back on that particular point, Sir Jonathan? Obviously, there are three devolved parliaments in the UK, as well as the UK Parliament. If And I don't have any specific example here, but if there were to be, in the past, if a particular instrument was brought forward by the UK Parliament, by the UK government to change, but I made a firm to change the travel restrictions to make things either harder or easier. And that was undertaken that way. If the devolved administrations had decided not to follow suit, to then obviously keep things separate, then I'm quite sure that there would have been political discourse challenging the devolved administrations as to why they weren't following suit, tried to keep things as tightly drawn as possible to have a kind of a four nations approach on that particular issue. Would you agree with that?
I think I probably would. I think it's just an example of a wider point, which is that I mean, nobody is claiming that any of this is easy, that deciding on the right policy response in an emergency and an unfolding a challenging picture, which we continue to see, nobody is saying that it's easy to identify what the right legal or policy response is. And as we've already said, sometimes it may just be necessary to act very quickly. But on the whole, you will end up with better policy and you are more likely to get consensus across the different countries of the UK, which is your point, but also you're likely to get better buy-in from businesses and other organisations that are affected by the law if you take a bit of time to get it right and to consult, and if the relevant administrations and their parliaments have an opportunity to consider and debate. It's easy to say that, and I accept in practice it's very difficult to do it at the height of an emergency, but it is, I think, true that you're more likely to get a consistent, thought-through, understood policy which people buy into and go along with if you take a bit of time to get it right. And again, where that doesn't happen, you will get disagreement, you will get inconsistency, you will get unintended gaps in the law and so on. And you will certainly get the position where parliamentarians and the public and businesses and those whose job it is to enforce the law will tend not really to have understood it, will not necessarily buy into it. And then you get problems of comprehension and enforcement, which maybe we want to come on to.
Good. No, thank you for that. I'm going to hand over to Craig Hoy. Craig.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Sir Jonathan and Professor Tierney. I think perhaps if I could open with you, Sir Jonathan. We heard from Dr. Ruth Fox last week, who talked about the impact that urgent and repeated delegated legislation can have on the clarity and therefore the accessibility of the law. And she said, and I quote, "One problem with the made affirmative procedure is that due to the pressure of urgency, legislation is pushed through quickly, therefore the scrutiny and the technical legal checks are missing. Therefore, the drafting problems get through and you have to either amend the regulations, which further adds to their complexity, or revoke them. In light of those concerns and the potential risks, therefore, Sir Jonathan, of the use of the made affirmative procedure, would you say that in technical drafting terms, that there is a tension between drafting at speed and the clarity of the instrument that's produced, and what, in your experience, can be done to mitigate the risks associated with drafting what can potentially be quite complex legislation at speed?
Well, I do agree with it. It's maybe a danger of everybody agreeing with everybody else in analysing what the problem is. But I do agree with that. And the Hansard Society, of course, has analysed in great detail the patterns and around the use of different procedures. But certainly I agree, one of the problems with legislating at speed is that the legislation will contain mistakes, the drafting will contain mistakes, or it will not be as clear as it would have been if more time had been allowed. And whenever I talk about this, I'm careful to express a lot of sympathy with the drafters because I used to be one and I used to be responsible for them. I mean, it is, of course, a very tough job to be asked to draft complex legislation when the policy is still being developed, perhaps days or even hours, it's still being finalised, just days or hours before the changes are due to come into force. That's a very tough call for any drafter. And particularly over time, what we've seen is legislating is multiple layers of amendment. You have a complicated instrument, and then that gets amended 2, 3, 4 times. And inevitably, that then becomes very complex and difficult to understand. And there is, as we have said, and as Dr. Fox has said, the risk simply that errors creep in. And there have been plenty of examples of that, and examples which the Hansard Society has identified of amending instruments needing to be brought forward very quickly and so on. And none of this is good for the comprehension of the law or for its enforcement or for clarity and so on. So it's easy to identify the problem, and it is sort of inevitable, I think, that this will happen when you have policy responses being finalised very quickly and the law having to be drafted very quickly. And it continues to happen. So just that the most recent regulations in Westminster, the ones dealing with the COVID pass, so-called, were made and laid yesterday, and they're coming into force tomorrow. And the latest face covering regulations were laid at 5 p.m. on the 9th, come into force on the following day. So this pattern of speed, I've talked about the risk of bad habits, this pattern of speed continues to be evident. So again, easy to identify the problem. What's the solution? The solution has to be, where possible, to allow more time for the development of the policy, for its testing, ideally its scrutiny by relevant parliaments, and then just more time for the drafting. And then it's a difficult, I accept, question of judgment as to how long is long enough. When you're balancing the need to legislate quickly, then the question is how quickly. Not everything is an absolute emergency. You're balancing the need to legislate nonetheless relatively quickly with the need to get the legislation right, both in policy terms and in drafting terms. And I, easy though it is to say, my feeling is that we have got the balance wrong too often over the course of the pandemic. In recent times, we are continuing still to prioritise the extreme urgency against the question of quality and comprehensibility of the legislation.
Just in follow-up to that, should it be accepted that on some occasions the urgency of a situation and the need to have the legislation in place takes precedence over clarity, and that can be revised later? Can you think of any examples where you would say recently that has been the case? Again, an unclear law has been better to have no law at all.
Well, I mean, these are difficult policy judgments, and it's not for me to second guess the policy. But if you go right back to the beginning of the pandemic, probably if you're going to introduce a lockdown, that's the highest kind of emergency one can imagine, a very, very tight lockdown. That's going to need to be done pretty quickly, possibly in hours or within a day. And I accept that may be the case when you're at the height of an emergency, and possibly it was then. I mean, ironically, it's probably true to say that legislating for very, very tight controls, legislating effectively for a lockdown, only minimal exception, is actually easier to do. It's easier to draft very tight, very clear laws than it is to legislate, as we saw later on in the pandemic, or partial closures and multiple exceptions, and then you're making distinctions between hair salons and chiropodists and so on. And these are, then you've got multiple policy judgments to be made. And my suggestion would be, where you're into that phase of a pandemic, probably it isn't quite so urgent to legislate today or tomorrow, and you should take a bit longer to get it right.
Yeah, I appreciate that. Professor Tierney, we heard from Morag Ross QC last week, who raised fears about the repeated use of delegated legislation on the accessibility off the law. And she said that the more instruments are made and the more they add to qualify, revoke in whole or in part update existing regulations, the more complex the picture becomes. And she goes on to say that repeated cycles of changing this or that are not conducive to accessibility. So in light of the fact that when delegated legislation is made urgently and comes into force before being considered by Parliament, does that, in your opinion, Professor Tierney, lead to challenges involving the accessibility of the law? And what would your specific concerns be in relation to that?
Yes, I think it does, Mr. Hoy, but I think to some extent the made affirmative procedure can become a bit of a straw man here. I think Sir Jonathan has elucidated this clearly, that the issue is a much broader one. And the issue really is one of constantly expanding executive power through larger, wider delegated powers, the increased use of Henry VIII powers, so powers to amend primary legislation, if what you could call super Henry VIII powers, which we're now seeing, which is the power to amend the parent statute itself, powers through regulation to create guidance rather than regulations themselves, which are themselves very difficult to enforce legally. So the made affirmative, the real problem with made affirmative is one of principle, in that the law is being made with no scrutiny. At least it is subject to affirmative procedure somewhere down the line. So a parliament does have to actively engage with it within a certain time period. The problem with a lot of the other powers is that they are made through negative procedure or, as I say, through guides, which are often subject to no parliamentary scrutiny after the event. So I think when we in the Constitution Committee in the Lords conducted a long inquiry into the legislative process, we talked a lot about the need for proper policy making that Sir Jonathan's touched upon, pre-legislative scrutiny in the making of the primary legislation where these powers are themselves first created. And without that, these problems do emerge. I'll give one example. I don't want to take too long, but I'll give an example, which I'm looking at the Nationality and Borders Bill at the moment. Immigration law in the United Kingdom is an absolute minefield of complexity. It's a problem of lack of accessibility, incomprehensible combination of primary and secondary legislation. And it affects them, often the most vulnerable people in society, often who don't have English as a first language. And legal practitioners tear their hair out trying to make sense of immigration law. Most of that was made with no urgency whatsoever, but it is very, very difficult for consumers, that term, to use. So certainly made affirmative is an issue. The urgency with which some, or the speed, if not urgency, with which a lot of these powers are made is a problem. But I think the Parliament needs to have a wider purview of the general problem. This habit that Sir Jonathan talked about of governments throughout the UK acting in this way very quickly, often because they just haven't got their act together to draft things properly on time, and then using urgency as an excuse. It's often late drafting rather than urgency that's the real issue.
Yeah. And just, I'm sure there probably isn't a formula that applies to it, but would your general impression be, Professor Tierney, that the more a law is amended, the less accessible and the less understandable it is?
It's certainly the case. And the other risk is, a lawyer should be able to go into a current statute and find the amendment. And tech has made it much easier to identify, what the recent provisions of a statute are. But certainly when you're getting into the world of having to look at delegated statutory instruments as well, that can be problematic. But I think a big problem is that we now have a number of different parent statutes being used to make these instruments. So you've got the Coronavirus Act being used, but you've also got the Scottish Acts being used, and then other public health related statutes. And the danger is that you find inconsistency among the different regulations, and a lack of clarity can creep in simply because you're having to look across a number of different instruments to try and find out what the law is. So yes, it becomes entirely Byzantine and you're really adding layer upon layer of complexity. And I think coronavirus and Brexit have both simply brought to a head what has been a much longer term problem through the different parliaments in terms of the growing complexity of law.
Thanks. And if we could just ask that same question to Sir Jonathan as well.
Well, again, boringly, I broadly agree with what Professor Tierney has said. I mean, for a start, complex policy will make complex law. I mean, only so much of the responsibility rests with the drafters. And of course, at various stages of the pandemic, we have seen very, very complex policies with, you know, certainly in England, we've had tiers with different rules applying to different tiers. We've had exception upon exception. All of these probably for understandable policy reasons. But as the law has got more complicated, we have seen different judgments as to what types of organisation need to apply what rules, who is exempt from them, and so on. And that produces complex law. It produces complex policy and it produces complex law. It also is capable of producing controversial and sometimes rather inconsistent law that I'd sort of jokingly referred to the rules on face coverings being different for cropodists as compared to hair salons. There may be good reasons for that. That may be a bad example, but you get the point. As you get complex policy and difficult judgments being made about who's in and who's out, inevitably that then leads to quite complex drafting, and you have to have exceptions and you have schedules and so on, and that's what we've now ended up with. The additional problem, which we keep coming back to, is when that is produced at speed, there is a greater risk of purely drafting errors slipping in, or simply the legislation being more complicated, more difficult to follow. And that we've also seen. And then the final point is that where you have, as we've said, multiple layers of instruments amending one another, it can be very difficult to follow the effect, the cumulative effect of the amendments. And one of the solutions to that, which I and some others have suggested, it's not a new idea, is that when you're doing that, you should at the same time produce a consolidated, amended version of the whole instrument, so you can see what the law now looks like in one place as amended. And that's extra work, and there may be good administrative reasons why it's quite difficult to do that, but there is no doubt that some kind of approach like that will make it easier at least to follow the effect when you have that kind of cumulative repeated amendment. And there are the gov.uk website does that in time. So it can happen, but it certainly helps. But again, if you're doing this at speed, it can take a while for that to be done. So looking the other day at the amendments to the face coverings regulations, all you had to go on was a very complicated instrument that was amending another instrument that had been made a few days before, and so on. And that's all very difficult to follow.
Thank you, Sir Jonathan. You've made a complex situation very clear. I will hand back to the convener there.
Thanks very much for that, Craig. I'm going to hand over to Graham Simpson.
Thanks very much, convener. And it's good to see you both, Professor Tierney and Sir Jonathan. I just want to sort of give you some figures which may sort of highlight the scale of the issue that we're dealing with. Between 2011 and 2019, here in Scotland, there were 9 affirmative instruments. And between the 20th of March 2020 and the 2nd of December this year, there were 132. So it's absolutely exploded. Most of them were COVID related, but not all, but the vast majority were COVID related. I mean, just picking up on the point that I think you both made about the complexity of law. I mean, I completely agree with that. It does become extremely difficult for people to follow unless it's consolidated, which it generally isn't. It certainly isn't here, and I suspect it's not in Westminster either. So I would say that as a personal point of view, I'd agree with what you said, Sir Jonathan, that we should move in that direction, because the law needs to be understandable. It's okay for you guys, you're experts, you can probably work things out, but most of us are not in that position, and it needs to be easily understood, particularly when you make making these laws at speed. You're expecting members of the public to know what's going on. You're expecting businesses to know what's going on. So, Jonathan, you made comments to the Statute Law Society on the rule of law and subordinate legislation. I did enjoy reading those comments. There was a good deal of humour in them, I'd say. But you've covered some of the points, and you seem to accept many of the reservations that some of us have over these instruments. You called for a reset, which you've done again today, but rather gloomily, you concluded that you won't hold your breath for that to happen. And I unfortunately have to agree with you on that. So I suppose a question to you both. Do you think if you give government an inch, they will take a mile? And I'll start with Sir Jonathan on that.
Well, thank you for your remarks about what I said to the Statute Law Society. Well, I'm just one voice, but I'm not the only voice. You've heard from the Hansard Society and the review that they have established. What we've also seen is the beginning of a debate. Well, you're obviously having it there in Scotland, but we've also seen it in London. I think you've seen the two reports of the House of Lords Scrutiny Committee. The exercise which the Hansard Society is leading has input from members of both Houses of Parliament. And interestingly, these are people that come from all parts of the policy debate on COVID. So there are people that think the government's gone too far. There are people that think it hasn't gone far enough. But the one thing they agree on is that there needs to be a proper debate and there needs to be better scrutiny. So we are seeing, I think, a healthy, at least the beginning of a healthy conversation about this. And I think probably the feeling is, as I've said, that the government has gone too far and it has taken a mile. Probably all the governments have done that. And it's understandable. It's understandable both in terms of responding to exceptional demands. Both COVID and Brexit have, for good or ill, have placed exceptional demands on governments, and that's led them to do exceptional things at exceptional speed. And that's understandable. It's also understandable from a kind of political human view that when it's sort of easier for a government, an administration, to legislate in this way, then why wouldn't you? And that's what we've seen, I think. This is my point about bad habits, because they're convenient. So all of that is understandable. And for it to change, it will need a whole combination of things. It will need leadership, it will need political leadership, it will need behavioural change. It will certainly involve members of all the parliaments, if I can put it this way, without patronising, you know, asserting themselves, as parliamentarians are starting to do and as scrutiny committees are doing. It will take all of those things. And I'm not saying it will be easy, because in the end you're up against government, and certainly speaking for Westminster, you've got a government with a strong majority. It may now be under challenge on some of these things, which, shall I say, that at least there's a debate, whatever you think about the merits of the measures on COVID. In fact, there's a debate is a good thing. So it will take all of those things to happen for this to change. But some of them are starting to happen. That's why I think it's a good debate. And I welcome this session. I welcome what the Lords committees have done. And I welcome what the Hansard Society is doing. But nobody's saying it's easy. Nobody's saying there's a quick fix. It will require this kind of debate and process to happen.
Professor Tini, I suspect you'd agree with that. So can I ask you something slightly different in that case? And I think you both touched on it earlier. And the question is, do you think we're actually in an emergency right now where we have to legislate at such speed? I'll give you an example. We here in the Scottish Parliament, we had legislation to deal with vaccine passports. This committee pushed back on that. It was put through, eventually it was put through under the made affirmative procedure. So at least when Westminster's getting a vote on it, we didn't have that luxury. Push through at speed, and yet it had been planned for weeks. So are we actually in the emergency that we're clearly in at the start of the pandemic that justifies the use of the MADIS affirmative procedure? That's to you, Professor Tierney.
Thank you, Mr. Simpson. I'm sorry I didn't get to answer the give them an inch, take a mile point.
I'm not stopping you.
I was going to say they don't just take a mile, they define in regulations what a mile means and then set up a public body to change to change a mile into a kilometre. So yeah, absolutely, that's what governments do. And you know, it's a serious point when you do give these powers, any parliament gives these powers, you have to remember you're giving them to very, very clever civil servants who then interpret them very, very broadly. And quite often they were the ones who drafted them in the first place. So they know exactly what they intend to do with them. I think you ask three very, I think there's, pardon me, three responses to the second question, which is parliaments have to be very robust in these situations. It's very easy for a claim of an emergency or a natural disaster. There was a very famous case during the Second World War in which the Court of Appeal said amid the clash of arms, the law is not silent. And I think Parliament should remember that amid any pandemic or any urgent process like Brexit, parliaments cannot remain silent. Parliaments continue to have a job to do to scrutinise the executive. And in fact, that job is more important during these situations because the powers that are being given are more significant than in normal times. I think there's two questions that arise as to urgency. First of all is what is actually an urgent or an emergency situation? And we have tended to get into a situation where we leave that to the executive. If you look at the European Convention on Human Rights, Article 15, that talks about emergencies, going back to the post-September 11 situation, that was left to the UK government to define what was an emergency in that case. And that was challenged very robustly. And I think parliaments should be really strong in saying, is this actually an urgent situation, or is it urgent because you've taken so long to draft measures, or you've sat on the policy for so long? Because once governments know they can do that, then what's to stop them bringing forward measures late and claiming that it's an emergency? And finally, who defines what an emergency is? So it's not just the objective test of what is an emergency, but who gets to define it? And here again, I think in primary legislation, if you look at the Coronavirus Act 2020, it was set out in very vague terms what the test was for the use of this power. And I think parliaments really need to pin down much more rigorously what an urgent situation is. And then, you know, I'm sure you'll come on to other things like sunset clauses and the things that are expressly excluded from the use of these powers. There are a whole raft of things that parliaments can do to curtail the use of these powers, but it's important that I think parliaments at this stage develop codes of practice for that.
Right, that's very useful. I'm actually now going to ask you about possibly introducing sunset provisions and any other thoughts that you might have that would improve transparency. I think the convener may want to explore later the matter of whether things are urgent or not, so we'll leave that to him to ask. So if I can ask you about, do you think introducing sunset clauses would be good, and have you got any other thoughts on how we could improve transparency? And seeing as you mentioned sunset clauses, Professor Tierney, we'll start with you.
Yeah, and I think they can serve two purposes. So you can have a sunset clause in the primary legislation itself for the use of the powers, and that is there. And we see that both in the UK Act and in the Scottish legislation, so much so that, you know, your own Parliament has recently passed another primary extension act. I think that's all good. I think the fact that the primary legislation and the primary powers run out is important. You have to be careful of extensions. If you put in any room for extension that will be used, see that in the Brexit legislation as well. So when you put in an extension power, you might as well say the sunset clause is the end of that extension power, because it will almost certainly be used. The second way in which a sunset power can be used is in relation to the instruments themselves after they are made. And I think that's an important consideration. It might also deal with the complexity point that we're talking about. If you really need a made affirmative measure for a very urgent consideration, well, why not bind that in time to run out at a certain point, so that so not just the power runs out, but the instrument that has been made runs out. And I don't see a reason not to include that within legislation. And a final point is, don't allow those powers to be reused. If it is so urgent that made affirmative has to be used on the first occasion that a power is used, there's absolutely no excuse 40 days or 6 months down the line to use made affirmative again. So I think those would be three qualifications that would help.
And before I come to Sir Jonathan, would you put a time period on what the sunset clause should be, or should it depend what the regulation is?
Well, I mean, in a sense, there's the 40-day period or the 28-day period, depending on which parliament, for the made affirmative to be approved. But it would depend on the circumstances, but possibly a six-month period, not unlike the period that's put in the use of the power itself.
Okay, so Jonathan.
Well, I don't really have much to add to that. I think certainly sunset clauses should be part of the armoury by which we control the use of these extreme powers. And we're talking here just about, you know, what's the right balance to strike situations where there really is an emergency and ministers therefore need to act very quickly, with ensuring that there is some kind of proper scrutiny or a later opportunity for Parliament to come back and revisit the issue. And sunset clauses, I think, achieve that. And on the question of who, and maybe we'll come back to this, who defines what an emergency is, I agree with what Professor Tierney said about the need for the enabling legislation. This question arises, first of all, in the enabling legislation. But secondly, assuming that in the end, somebody has got to be able to decide when something is an emergency and therefore when procedures are short-circuited, and that probably is going to end up being the minister. So you get the test as tight as you can, and therefore I think this is a suggestion that was made by Dr. Fox. You make provision requiring the minister in some way to explain and be held accountable for relying on that test. So these are all, I mean, again, I say we may come on to this, but these are all just examples of ways in which you balance what are very wide powers with some kind of constraint and some kind of accountability. And I think sunset clauses are definitely part of that.
Thank you. And that takes us seamlessly back to the convener.
It does. Thank you very much for that, Graham. So on the matter of urgency, now, as already has been touched upon, as you said, Sir Jonathan, the comments from Dr. Fox in the committee last week. Do both witnesses, do you have any type of framework or any type of recommendations by way of the definition of urgency or what the mechanism should be put in place? That governments have to follow before utilising the made affirmative. We'll start with yourself, Sir Jonathan.
Well, I don't have a draft sitting in front of me. I mean, let's be honest. Any draft, any definition is going to have to allow some kind of margin of interpretation and judgment for the person making the decision. But no doubt there are ways in which one can confine and define a definition of emergency so that it really hits the things you're worried about. But if you're talking about a public health emergency, there are only so many ways one can define that. I think more important then is how you hold the minister accountable for the judgment that he's made that there is indeed such an emergency. And I think much of this was touched on by Dr. Fox, that, you know, that requiring a public explanation of the reasons rather than just a statement that there is an emergency, setting out the reasons, setting out the evidence for it within reason, possibly requiring, even in conditions of real emergency, requiring the minister to make a statement in Parliament there and then. If ministers can give press conferences, they can go to Parliament. Some provision, even at that stage, for a debate or for questioning in which ministers can be held account for the judgment they have made, even if it can't at that stage be overturned. These, I think, are all sort of salutary mechanisms. Again, these are all about achieving balance. But when you're giving very wide powers and in the end, potentially a wide discretion to a minister to decide that something is an emergency, at least you're requiring that minister to come to the elected assembly and to explain the reasons why they reached that decision and be held accountable for it. So some version of those things, I think, could just help again to reset the balance.
Okay, I'll come back to that in a moment. Professor Tierney?
Yes, I agree it's very difficult to take the definition of an emergency or urgency away from a government. And let's be very clear here, you know, this is a very, very difficult issue. No one's suggesting any degree of impropriety, I think, on the part of governments when they respond to this health crisis. That everyone's trying to do their best, I'm sure. But I think the issue then really does become much more of a downstream one. We saw that even with Article 15, which says that the emergency has to be threatening to the life of the nation. Governments use that, and you know, we accepted this in some of the anti-terrorism legislation. So it's very difficult to imagine this being second-guessed, for example, by a court. I don't really see any role for that. The real issue then is what powers are you giving to government in that situation? What can they do with them? And that really has to be something for which the government has to be accountable. And you can restrict it by how long they can use those powers. You can exclude specifically certain things they cannot do. You can't create criminal offences. You can't deny people citizenship. Whatever it might be, you know, there are certain things you can build in. You can't fundamentally violate the Human Rights Convention. And also you can build in scrutiny after the event. And I think these are the really important dimensions of it. It's not so much that there is an emergency. It's this broader question of what powers you're giving to government and how robust Parliament is in checking what they're doing with them.
So, we've lost your sound, Professor Tierney.
Sorry. Can you hear me now, convener?
Yes, I can now.
Yeah, sorry. I think I'd finished, but I was simply saying that the crucial thing is that Parliament is really scrutinising what governments are doing with those powers. And I think another big issue is that the primary legislation, I come back to this point, we can take our eye off the ball with the made affirmative procedure. It is, as a mark of principle, problematic. But in many ways, Parliament has longer scrutinised those made affirmative instruments after the event than they have often to scrutinise the primary legislation which created those powers, which often passes through Parliament in a day or two. And I think that's where the really hard questions have to be asked. You know, should this legislation be passing so quickly? And should it be brought back very quickly for thorough post-legislative scrutiny, the whole bill, which I think is something we should really be thinking about in these major pieces of legislation.
I've lost that sound again, Professor Taylor.
Sorry, I'd finished there.
That would be.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you for that. Can I just go back to Sir Jonathan? Sir Jonathan, you had made some suggestions by way of. Sorry, Professor Tierney, I think you're still talking there, but there's no volume coming through. Are you finished?
Sorry, no, I wasn't. I'll remute myself. Sorry.
Okay, no problem. Thank you. Sir Jonathan, you spoke a moment ago of some aspects and some things that could happen by way of or trying to have more scrutiny. And I know Graeme Simpson had given the example earlier of the COVID passport when that order came into the British Parliament. And so, just I'm not sure if you're aware, but prior to the order, actually the final order coming into the Parliament, you know that there were statements took place in the chamber, and also questions to the relevant minister, and also the minister had came, the parliamentary business minister had came in front of our committee and took questions from the committee. And so there were a few things that actually did happen in that particular instance regarding the pre-scrutiny. Not, I accept, not so much scrutiny of the actual order, but certainly there was there were opportunities to have that dialogue and have some of that scrutiny to the relevant minister. Clearly, colleagues might not have been happy with some of the responses from the minister, but obviously that will happen in every single parliament. But also that particular situation, it hasn't happened in every single made affirmative that has came into this parliament. And well, obviously I can't comment about elsewhere. But I wanted to make you aware of that, of those actions that took place, because it clearly was an instrument that had a lot more public interest to it, as well as political interest to it, compared to many other of the made affirmatives that have come into this committee and also into this parliament. So can I just ask a question to certainly both Professor Tierney and Sir Jonathan on the issue of the of legislation and the legal requirement to provide the evidence of urgency. I think certainly from what you both said, it's clear that obviously more information should be presented. And should that be put in on a legal footing? And if that's the case, do you have any examples of existing legislation that can actually help with that, certainly with the situation that we currently face? And clearly COVID is not going away anytime soon. So we will be living with this for quite some time to come, whether it's in the emergency situation that we currently have, or at some point further down the line when society has returned to a more normal state. I'll start off with Professor Tierney.
Yes, it's very difficult to think of other legislation where governments have had to define precisely what they mean by an emergency. I think the issue is not so much in terms of defining emergency as an issue. You know, the health crisis is what it is, and there's no doubt about that, you know, in many ways, but it's what you do in response to that. I think this is what requires justification. Yes, we have a pandemic, but if you're going to pass these instruments, which of them genuinely need to be made without any parliamentary scrutiny, and why? Why does this have to be made into law without any level of parliamentary scrutiny? And why could it not have been brought forward earlier? And I think it would be possible for Parliament to draw up a very rigorous checklist that, so the equivalent of the sort of delegated powers memorandum or human rights memorandum that governments have to submit ahead of legislation to show that they've done due diligence on those fronts. I think we're now at the stage that this pandemic has been with us long enough, whereby government bringing forward legislation without parliamentary process could explain that this is an extremely exceptional situation, that Parliament can't even get a few days or a couple of weeks to look at something. And there should be a checklist of explaining exactly what the power is to be used for, why it is so urgent, and why it could not have been brought forward earlier. So I think some form of pre-legislative memorandum accompanying each of these instruments, explaining very, very clearly why it is so urgent, is maybe one way for Parliament to get some initial scrutiny. And if Parliament's unhappy, then there should be a process to call this measure in for proper scrutiny.
Okay, thank you for that. Sir Jonathan?
I can't think of a specific example, but I don't see why you couldn't have a combination of a legal requirement and a parliamentary procedure, which requires the minister, when relying on very urgent powers, to explain why. You could have the parent statute could include a requirement that says when the minister is has determined that a situation is particularly urgent, he must set out and publish an explanation for the reasons he's reached that decision and why he thinks it's necessary to legislate in reliance on that urgent procedure. And that might be backed up by a method of parliamentary accountability that means he has to come to Parliament and explain the reasons for that. So I think there are mechanisms that one could have for doing that. I mean, this is recognising that the existence of an emergency may itself be politically, or at least the extent of the emergency, may itself be politically controversial. I mean, maybe everybody accepted right at the beginning that there was, you know, we're in a coronavirus emergency and all governments needed to act quickly. But the reason why having this conversation really is that down the road, at various stages, views have differed, and they differ today, as to how grave the emergency is, first of all, and secondly, whether the emergency really justifies relying on urgent procedures for particular measures. And that's the debate that's going to be happening in the Westminster Parliament about whether the Omicron variant has heightened the emergency to such an extent that we now need to introduce these new measures on COVID passports and further restrictions on face covering and so on. So the very fact of the emergency or the extent of the emergency is itself politically contentious. So all the more reason why, if ultimately you're giving powers to ministers to decide that, that they should be accountable for them and that there should be at least some opportunity, however urgent, for a debate around that. And I haven't got a template, but I think it would be possible to devise a combination of legal and parliamentary procedures requiring that.
Okay, no, thank you for that. Can I just ask one question regarding, Professor Tierney touched upon September the 11th, and as I was preparing for today, it struck me also regarding the events of 9/11, also when mad cow disease came into the UK. Are you aware of any measures that came in, particularly regarding made affirmative, mostly regarding made affirmative, any particular measures that came in and if there was any other aspects of scrutiny that came in along with the made affirmative? Clearly these two events, huge that they were, they've clearly had an impact upon life ever since. I'll start with yourself first of all, Sir Jonathan.
Well, I obviously agree that they were huge emergencies, and they led to very extensive legislative responses. I'm going back to a point Professor Tierney made earlier. The debate about made affirmative is just one example of a wider debate about how governments legislate in an emergency and what's the role for Parliament in that. So I can't offhand again think of examples of particular procedures that were used in response to 9/11 or mad cow or these other things. I mean, from memory, a lot of the legal response to 9/11 was, of course, intensely controversial, not least the treatment of suspected terrorists and so on, and what you do about people that you can't try. And we had control orders and TPIMs and all of those measures. Intensely controversial they were, and they all needed primary legislation. So I don't think to anything like the same extent was their reliance on pre-existing emergency legislation to do things by, I'm not saying it didn't happen, I haven't got details in front of me, but the main legislative responses, controversial though they are and in many ways still remain, would have been done by primary legislation, sometimes certainly at speed, but nonetheless in a way that allowed, at least some measure of parliamentary debate and scrutiny. So it's an example of the same thing, but I suspect it's not, it's less an issue about using secondary legislation or made affirmative. And then for good measure, of course, many of those legal responses ended up being challenged in the courts, in some cases successfully challenged, precisely because they involved very delicate, controversial balances between responding to an emergency and the effect on individuals' liberties and so on. And those are difficult judgments, and they needed legislation, but very often the legislation was itself challenged.
Okay, well, thank you, Sir Jonathan. Professor Tierney.
Yeah, a couple of reflections. I mean, one is that the Anti-Terrorism, Crime and Security Act, going back, you know, to 2001, introduced a power, but the power was largely to detain people without trial. And mercifully, the Human Rights Act and other civil liberties law was in place whereby that could be challenged by individuals before the courts. I think what we've seen in the time since then is that delegated powers, which were, I think Sir Jonathan's right, delegated powers, lawmaking powers, were not a big issue in the 2001 Act, but they have become such a banality now that we almost take for granted wide Henry VIII powers, guidance-making powers that are not subject to any scrutiny by the courts. These have now crept into our legislation. It's been exacerbated by the need for an urgent response to Brexit, and now an urgent response to the coronavirus. And there are potentially very wide civil liberties issues emerging from these that I think are not being properly addressed. We've seen court cases on closing of churches, for example, that have been challenged. And there are restrictions on people's liberty in the lockdown measures. These are not typically now being challenged under human rights legislation with any success. But I think we do need to take into account the broader picture that over those 20 years, exacerbated by these two huge events in our country's history, has led to the accrual of extensive executive powers, which I think in 2001 would have seemed breathtaking powers in many ways. And I think this inquiry and other related inquiries are an opportunity to sit back and say, this is not just about made affirmative. Maybe the Scottish Parliament needs to have a real thorough inquiry into the broad use of delegated powers more widely, and the extent to which Brexit legislation and now coronavirus legislation is empowering the executive far too much at the expense of Parliament.
Okay, no, thank you for that, Professor Tierney. So I'd just like to hand over to Graham Simpson. Just one thing. Clearly, Dr. Fox on the record in the Terror Committee last week had indicated that this type of debate has been going on since the early 1930s. So it's obviously not a new debate, and clearly nobody has managed to get to an outcome, a successful outcome, over that period of time. But I would also imagine that even if a successful outcome were found at some point in the past, then different events happen and different solutions are then required for those also. Professor Tierney? You're on mute.
Sorry, yes. And I do want to qualify what we're saying. Look, the reason why this has been an issue since the 30s is because we've got bigger governments since the 30s, much of which has been a great thing. You know, we have a welfare system, we have a health service, we have all of these things that require big government. So I don't think anyone's arguing that government should not be given power. Government should be given power. We need governments to do things. I think what you're focusing on is government being given lawmaking power, and government being given lawmaking power that is not subject to scrutiny. So I do want to very much confine my remarks to the constitutional issue. I'm not entering into an ideological criticism of big government. There are very good reasons why we do have big government.
Okay, no, thank you. So Jonathan, do you want to come in on that, and then I'll move on to Graham?
Well, only just to share the reflection that this is not a new debate. It's been going on as long as you've had secondary legislation, and it's not going to go away. The use of secondary legislation is now well established, and in many ways a perfectly sensible part of our system of making law. And you could not go back to the day when every minor change of the law had to be done by primary legislation. So the debate will go on forever. It's about what the right balance is and what the checks are when you do confer these powers on ministers. And that's the debate we're having. And as everybody accepts, that debate has been thrown into new relief. And you gave the stats from Scotland yourself as a result of the demands of Brexit and the demands of COVID. And that's why it's a good thing to have the debate again. It's not a new debate, but we should have it again because it's now become just more salient because of those things.
Great. No, thank you for that. Graham Simpson wants to come in on our supplementary. Graham.
Yeah, thanks again, Vina. Just want to ask a quick question around this sort of urgency question. If we were to develop, if we're to develop a procedure where a minister has to justify why something is urgent or not, why something is urgent, you could imagine any minister really just seeing this as something they just have to do, a bit of a tick box exercise. Maybe they might have to go along to some bothersome committee, but they'll just get through it. And at the end of the day, they decide it's urgent, it's urgent. Should we build into any system the power of veto for Parliament and or a committee? I'll ask that to you both. So we'll start off with Professor Tierney.
Yes, and with respect, Parliament does have a veto in not giving the power in the first place in the primary legislation. Now, I appreciate that that's a bit more attenuated in this case, since the initial power was given by Westminster in the Coronavirus Act. But, you know, I do think that the first step really is for the Parliament, when these powers are being given, to really question how they've been drafted and how the definition of emergency is being drafted. And if it's possible simply not to pass legislation on that basis. Another thing is, and I think we've both touched on this, is that the issue is not so much the definition of an emergency, but what happens pursuant to it. And I think it's very important to put in, by virtue of having a set of principles, what does not go into these powers. For example, they cannot be used to create criminal offences. They cannot be used to impinge upon the Human Rights Act or Convention Rights under the Scotland Act. They can't be used to change primary legislation. They can't be used to create public bodies. They cannot operate retrospectively. You can have a whole series of very quick qualifications that go in relation to any power that is claimed in relation to an emergency or in relation to a power that's going to be exercised by made affirmative procedure, so that you're immediately excluding a whole range of possible abuses. I think that would probably be more useful than trying to second guess what emergency means, because as a number of people have said, it's a test the government will assert, and it's a test, as we now know from the courts, that the courts are very reluctant to second guess.
Mr. Jonathan?
Well, I would only say, I mean, you referred to the risk of any test being a tick box. And I think probably what I've suggested and what Professor Tierney suggested is that you could have something that's more than, certainly, how would you put it, more demanding than that. So certainly more demanding than we have now, which is basically just assertion. So something that actually requires some kind of explanation and evidence and some kind of debate. There's a risk that even that becomes just a sort of charade. But I mean, I think we have to hold out some sort of hope that accountability means something. And even if it doesn't involve a veto, having properly to account as a minister for the judgments you've made is worth doing. And it tends to concentrate minds, and it will create better, ultimately, over time, better decision making and policy making. I'm sort of trying to hold on to that truth, so that even that kind of control will be better than a tick box, and it'll be better than we have now. As to whether you then build in, as it were, a veto, I think I'm probably with Professor Tierney, which is you just have to, you know, if you're in this system where ministers in the end sometimes just need to act very quickly, or simply there isn't parliamentary time to allow a full debate and a vote on every single instrument, then you've got to decide what are the things where you need that heightened level of control, where you do actually need Parliament positively to vote for or against something. And Professor Tierney suggested a list, and actually the list I suggested in my lecture is not so very dissimilar, that, you know, there'll be some things you just don't allow a minister to do on the nod, and there has to be a debate on, or some heightened kind of scrutiny. And then you have a debate about, I think again, as Professor Tierney said, you have a debate at the stage of conferring the power as to where you draw the line and how much leeway you give the minister. So some combination of those things, I would suggest.
Okay. Thanks.
Okay. Thank you, Graham. I'm going to hand over to Bill Kidd.
Thank you very much, convener. And thank you very much indeed to both of our guests. Now, I'm not going to take you back over everything that you've said. You'll be very pleased to hear. However, more IQ, Ross QC, when she was speaking to us recently, emphasised the importance of parliamentary democracy and the rule of law, and how there was a perceived increase in executive power. Now, it wasn't about COVID. It was basically on observations of whether there's a more general shift away from legislative power towards executive, and if so, why this might be the case. If there hadn't been COVID, do you think that in general terms, in the governments in the UK, there has been a more general shift away from legislation through parliamentary debate and the committee system towards the executive? And could Professor Tierney take that one first, please?
I don't think there's any doubt about that. My principal experience is at Westminster advising the Constitution Committee, but obviously I take a very close interest in the Scottish Parliament's lawmaking too. There is no doubt that there are far more delegated instruments than there ever were. There is no doubt that there are far more Henry VIII powers in legislation than there used to be. I see that even in the 60 years I've been doing that job. As I say, there are now super Henry VIII powers that allow for the amendment of the parent statute. There is the giving of guidance powers, whereby ministers can, in effect, create rules which are not necessarily legally enforceable, but they are very restrictive as to, say, for example, local authorities. We see it in the immigration rules in relation to nationality law, and also powers to set up public bodies, which we see all the time now in Brexit legislation. So there are all kinds of reasons for this. We've talked about urgency. We talked about the fact that after Brexit, there's been a need to try and deal with 20,000 or however many instruments there are that are retained EU law. All of these are undoubtedly pressing concerns. But I think that in many other ways, it's simply convenient for government to kick the can down the road as to what rules they will need. Putting it in delegated legislation makes it much more convenient because you're not subjected to scrutiny and headlines at the time that you pass a bill. So that it suits civil servants who can draft the rules that will take effect at their leisure. Later on, in response to issues as they arise. So there are all kinds of reasons why this has happened, but the very fact of it, I think, is irrefutable. And I think it's potentially very dangerous.
Thank you. Just on the back of that, do you believe that scrutiny by the committees in the systems that we have, such as this committee and, say, even the COVID-19 Recovery Committee, do you believe that potentially they could be afforded a greater opportunity to take their debates, their scrutiny towards fulsome parliamentary debate, which would circumvent to some degree the executive domination of these powers?
I think the Scottish Parliament is already in a slightly difficult situation because of its unicameral nature, and that does undoubtedly, you know, Westminster, for all the faults of the House of Lords that I'm sure many members will talk about, is a check, and it operates as a check, and it has specialist committees that will conduct review of delegated powers. So there's a dedicated delegated powers committee, of course you also have. But there's also the Constitution Committee and the Joint Committee on Human Rights, which is overseeing these powers on a regular basis and doing a second level of legislative scrutiny. So I think that is already a difficult situation to be in. And I'm sure your committee, like every committee, is now overwhelmed by the volume of work that you have. So I'm not inclined to blame parliaments for this at all. I think parliaments are doing the best job they can, and there may well be measures that they can bring forward to try and draw this to the attention of parliament, plenary parliament, more fulsomely. I really do think there is need for a broader inquiry into the growth and the creep, if you like, executive creep in the granting of these powers and the exercise of these powers. So I'm sure there are procedural mechanisms you could use to draw these to the attention of Parliament. But I think the overwhelming issue is that resources will get in the way, and I'm sure you must be overwhelmed by the volume of this stuff.
Thank you very much. And Sir Jonathan, do you have anything to add there?
Well, I agree with Professor Tierney's analysis of the trend. I think that's irrefutable. Part of this is simply, you know, is simply the politics, and certainly in Westminster, which I'm most familiar with, you have a government with a strong majority, and it hitherto has shown that it can control the House of Commons and therefore limit scrutiny, and that's what governments tend to do when they can. I agree that the scrutiny committees play an important role, where scrutiny can't be done on the floor of the House because there isn't time and just don't allow for it. There has been some first-class work done by some of the scrutiny committees, both in the Lords, and we've mentioned them, but also some of the Commons committees. I gave evidence to the Justice Committee not long ago. So there is valuable scrutiny being done there. It's not the same as requiring ministers to come and justify and let alone have a vote on what they're doing. I think the other point is that, which is why we're having this conversation, it's very difficult to go backwards. When you've seen a trend like this, when you and I've been a civil servant for many years, I know what it's like. You've developed a clever new way of conferring powers. You've got precedents for Henry VIII powers. The next time a bill comes along, you cleverly devise a yet more extensive Henry VIII power, and the government gets it through because it has a majority. Well, you've got a precedent, and it may be very convenient to use it again. And the direction tends always to be one way, kind of ratchet. And what government is then ever going to give up that kind of control and go backwards and actively choose more scrutiny? So that's the truth, that you tend to go in one direction. But again, all the more reason to have this conversation and ask, actually, is this in the wider benefit of good governance under any political party? Does this make for good law and good governance and public confidence in the law? And I think we're saying on the whole, it doesn't.
Thank you very much to both of you. And thank you, convener, please.
Thank you, Bill. I'm going to hand over to Paul Sweeney.
Thank you, convener, and thanks to our witnesses today for giving such comprehensive and expert evidence. It seems to me that perhaps this is all a function of the lack of a codified constitution. Perhaps that's maybe a more fundamental debate that we need to have. But I was intrigued by the issue about introducing a sense of a defined urgency as a check. So could this potentially be a lever that could perhaps, you know, stop the ratchet moving further forward? and how might that actually practically impact on the future exercise of executive power? And I'd like to direct that question in the first instance to Sir Jonathan.
I think, well, we've talked about what form a kind of urgency test might take. I think there is scope for doing something wider, which could include that, but which could include other constraints. And again, there's a kind of shopping list that I and others have suggested, ways in which you constrain the exercise of these powers, ways which you impose controls on them and greater levels of scrutiny. Some of that could even be done. I mean, the Lords committees have simply recommended revising the guidance on legislation that is in Westminster, in Whitehall, is developed by the Cabinet Office, that we just have a change of behaviour on the part of the civil service. And so some of that could be done relatively informally. And I've suggested that we should go further and have a new Statutory Instruments Act. We have a very outdated Statutory Instruments Act of 1946, which basically sets out a framework for statutory instruments. But I've suggested that what we could do with is a statute that contains many more controls around how secondary legislation is made, what procedures apply to it, potentially even how it's published and printed and so on. Now, that's not a written constitution, and under our system, such an act could itself then later on be changed and overridden. But it would be a visible, it would certainly be a reset of the kind I've suggested. Again, talking from a Westminster perspective, I certainly think it would be worth doing that.
And thank you very much. And Professor Tierney, do you have any thoughts on this matter?
Briefly, I agree that an option would be some kind of legislative code. So there's a ministerial code that regulates ministerial conduct. And I think there is now sufficient agreement among people as to what is good and bad practice in the drafting of legislation in terms of how delegated powers are drafted, Henry VIII clauses and so on. And I think a legislative code that drafters could use, and which would point out that certain approaches are exceptional and can only be used in very exceptional situations, which must constantly be justified. We already have that in delegated powers memorandum, but I think something that really shows it to be unacceptable except in very exceptional circumstances is the way to go. Because I think civil servants are drafting things based upon what previous people have done. They're trying to do things quickly. They're trying to do the will of the minister. And I think often from conversations that we have with behind the scenes, with bill committees, with drafting teams, often they don't see anything wrong with this stuff. It's not as though they're trying to pull the wool over Parliament's eyes. And I think a clear, transparent legislative code that sets out what good and bad drafting from a constitutional perspective is, would at least set the tenor. And it would allow parliaments, when these measures come before them, to say, no, this goes against the code, go back and do this again. We're not passing this.
That's very helpful. I think, I suppose, necessity is the mother of invention sometimes. And you described the time constraints that might drive behaviours that might not necessarily be malicious in intent or malign in intent, but they just simply are a sort of byproduct of some other pressures in the system. And perhaps this could assist. I think those suggestions were really helpful. Dr. Fox, when she was giving her evidence, described a trend towards writing or drafting skeleton bills that are by their very architecture prone to being allowed to be massively, expanded upon by secondary legislation. And that perhaps is a sort of trend of design of our legislation that might have meant the propensity to use the delegated powers in such a way in recent years has expanded so significantly. So I was just wondering if you're looking at sort of recent primary legislation and the nature of the powers that have been given to ministers and that, what that might actually mean for the exercise of executive powers in the future. And would you agree with that sort of observation that skeleton bills and the architecture of bills have substantially changed in recent years, and that perhaps is driven some of the, or certainly given light to some of the behaviours and use of expanded secondary legislation that we've seen. And that could perhaps tie into your points about the codes or potentially even legislation to sort of tighten up how these are designed.
I'll just follow up, Mr. Sweeney, since I was answering, it seems to flow. I mean, three examples, I can just think off the top of my head, not just skeleton bills, which are common, but fast track legislation. The fact that legislation is going through so quickly, such a code might provide that when a bill is being fast tracked, that is not the place for these kind of measures, or they're required to be even more intense scrutiny in relation to delegated powers, where there has been no scrutiny of the primary legislation. And a third example I've come across recently is placeholder clauses, where a clause is simply named in a draft bill that can go through part of its parliamentary process with no detail. The clause is then added at committee. So wonders, there are new things emerging all the time that one is constantly amazed at what governments are trying to get away with. I think Sir Jonathan has said this is a one directional process, and governments never relinquish powers they have unless they're made to. But those are three other areas where we see trends now towards fast legislation, very thin legislation, but thin legislation that's packed with delegated powers downstream, which are then subject to potentially no scrutiny. It's deeply problematic from a constitutional perspective, and it applies throughout the UK.
Certainly, quite a cause for concern. Thanks very much. Can I just invite Sir Jonathan, if you have any thoughts on that second question?
Not much to add. I mean, having been a civil servant as long as I was, I mean, I saw examples of all these things, but I agree, we are simply seeing more of it. So it's just another example of this one-way trend that we've talked about. I agree, it's mostly not malign. It is simply a feature of our structure and often of our politics that ministers will want to bring forward a bill on a particular topic to show that they are active on a particular subject, or the time in the parliamentary cycle has come around that it's convenient for them to bring forward a bill with a particular heading at a time when the policy is not fully developed. I mean, that's the other incentive behind this. It's the kind of political, practical demands of being seen to legislate on a topic before the policy is truly developed. That's another reason why you get these very thin skeleton bills. And you rightly say that tends then to mean that the detail has to be fleshed out later by secondary legislation, and that inevitably gets less scrutiny than the detail in the bill would have done. So it is just another example of the same thing.
Very much appreciate that. Thank you very much, convener.
Thank you. So just as we're about to close, but before we do, I'd like to ask the witnesses if you have any additional comments or points that you would like to highlight that you don't feel as if have already been covered. Start off with yourself first of all, Sir Jonathan.
Well, I don't think I do. I think we've covered all the issues. I mean, you've detected quite a high degree of agreement as to what the problem is. I do think, as I've said, that it is healthy that there is now a debate about that issue, that there is some agreement there is a problem, both here and in Westminster. And I would like to see, I think the Hansard Society process will help. I'm sure this committee's report will help, that we need to take advantage of that momentum and start coming up with some solutions, which I hope we started to do.
Well, thank you for that, Sir Jonathan. And Professor Tierney.
Simply to echo that I very much welcome what the committee is doing, and to make a plea for interparliamentary cooperation, which I know is going on in text, because I think the parliaments of the UK have much to learn from each other in how you regulate government.
Okay, no, thank you for that, Professor Tierney. And with that, I'd like to thank both Professor Tierney and Sir Jonathan Jones QC for their helpful evidence, and also add that the committee may wish to follow up by letter with any additional questions stemming from the meeting, also discussion later on this morning. So with that, once again, thank you very much to you both gentlemen, and I will briefly suspend the session to let the witnesses leave, please. Thank you. Before we move to our consideration of SSIs, we are meeting online today, and it will be more challenging for members to indicate agreement to the items being discussed. I therefore ask you to raise your hand if you're not content with the question being put, or if you wish to speak about an instrument. Under agenda item number 3, we're considering instruments subject to the made affirmative procedure. No issues have been raised on SSIs 2021-454 and 455. Is the committee content with these instruments? Thank you. No member has indicated that they're not content or that they wish to speak, and so we are agreed. Under agenda item number 4, we're considering instruments subject to the affirmative procedure. An issue has been raised on the draft Scottish Child Payment Regulations 2020 and the Disability Assistance for Children and Young People, Scotland Regulations 2021, Miscellaneous Amendments Regulations 2022. The regulations are made as part of a wider legislative framework for the administration of social security assistance in Scotland provided and for by the Social Security Scotland Act 2018. Section 97(9) of this Act includes a requirement on the Scottish Ministers at the time of laying the instrument to also lay a response with the Scottish Commission on Social Security's the report on the proposals for the regulations, or a statement explaining why Ministers considered it appropriate to lay the draft instrument before the Commission has submitted its report on the proposals for the regulations. One set of amendments in this instrument were not reported on by the Commission prior to laying the instrument. A statement under Section 97(9)(b) sent to the Social Justice and Social Security Committee on the 1st of December. The statement was not laid until the 3rd of December. In a written response to a question from the committee, which can be found on the public pages for this meeting, the Scottish Government has apologised for this administrative oversight. Does the committee agree to report the instrument under the general reporting ground in respect of a failure to lay the necessary statement when laying the draft instrument on the 29th of November 2021, as required under Section 97(9)(b) of the Social Security Scotland Act 2018. And while the committee may wish to welcome the Scottish Government's apology for this administrative oversight and acknowledge that this oversight was only related to one set of minor technical amendments in the instrument, and was corrected within 4 days, clearly a breach of the laying requirements. Does the committee also wish to write to the Minister for Parliamentary Business to highlight its desire for all instruments to be laid correctly? And no member has indicated that they are not content or that they wish to speak, and so are we agreed? Also, under this agenda item, no points have been raised on the draft redress for survivors, historical child abuse and care, reconsideration and review of determinations, Scotland Regulations 2022. Is the committee content with this instrument? No member has indicated that they are not content or that they wish to speak, and so we are agreed. Under agenda item number 5, we are considering an instrument subject to the negative procedure. An issue has been raised on SSI 2021-446, Prisons and Young Offenders Institutions Scotland Amendment Rules 2021. This instrument amends the Prisons and Young Offenders Institutions Scotland Rules 2011. It was laid before the Parliament on the 30th of November, came into force on the 13th of December 2021. Accordingly, it does not respect the requirement in Section 28(2) of the Interpretation and Legislative Reform Scotland Act 2021 that at least 28 days should elapse between the laying of an instrument subject to the negative procedure and the coming into force of that instrument. Before I invite comments from members on whether the breach of the 28-day rule was appropriate, does the committee agree to report the instrument under Reporting Ground J for failure delayed in accordance with the laying requirements under the Interpretation and Legislative Reform Scotland Act 2010. In terms of the explanation provided by the Scottish Government for the breach, members will also have seen the correspondence from the Scottish Centre for Crime and Justice Research, where the letters perhaps focus more on wider policy concerns rather than under our technical remit, they do focus on the speed that these changes have been implemented. And with that, I'll invite comments from members. Mr. Simpson, then Mr. Hoy.
Thanks very much, convener. And given our earlier session, I think this actually highlights why scrutiny is important. And that is why we have a 28-day rule to allow some form of scrutiny. Now, on the face of it, you know, a lot of people will think what the Scottish Government's done here is the right thing to do, that they push through this regulation. But you've mentioned the letters that Parliament's received from the Scottish Centre for Crime and Justice Research, which actually puts a counter-argument forward. And that's why we need to have scrutiny. So, you know, I'm afraid breaching that 28-day rule, whatever you think of the policy, is really not acceptable. And we need to tell the government that in no uncertain terms.
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Simpson. Mr. Hoy, and then Mr.
Thank you, convener. I think just to look at how we got here, just in light of Mr. Simpson's remarks and the evidence we've taken earlier about the government getting into bad habits and maybe drafting and laying things too late, even though they had the policy intent earlier. I mean, obviously, this was first raised, I think, by my colleague Russell Finlay on September the 1st with Keith Brown in committee, and then it was raised again on September the 15th in the chamber with Keith Brown. September the 16th, my colleague Russell Finlay wrote to the Justice Minister. Then he raised it again on September the 29th with the Drugs Minister in the chamber, and then in a further letter on the 26th of October. Obviously, the intent to bring the policy in was then announced on November the 2nd. And then, so if what we're to read, if the government's reason for bringing it forward is that there was a major incident at the end of November, I think what we're seeing perhaps here is that maybe ministers had been asleep at the wheel to some degree, and were only really awoken by Russell Finlay, and that therefore the 28 days could have been quite adequately covered had they brought this forward earlier, so that we can have what I think is, providing it does what it says on the tin, potentially a good a piece of legislation, bringing forward a policy that's proportionate, timely and practical. But I think what it does expose is that if perhaps the government is not planning properly for bringing forward this kind of legislation, then we do get into a situation whereby we're not having adequate scrutiny. And I think for these kinds of instruments and the legislation to have public confidence, then I think the public would expect us to have had due time for consultation and for that all-important scrutiny. So I very much support the intent of the policy. I think there are some concerns that it may not do what it's setting out to do, but certainly the principle behind the policy very much in favour of, but I do share the concerns of Mr. Simpson that how we got here is not sufficient or adequate.
Thank you, Mr. Hoy. Mr. Sweeney.
Thank you, convener. Yeah, I would like to raise significant concerns with this policy. I think it represents an abuse of power. I think it represents the overreach of the executive and insufficient scrutiny or evidence that it is going to achieve its purported effects. And I think for all those reasons, it's an appropriate use of the procedure and should be resisted on that basis. So I would be inclined to, at the very least, write to the lead committee on policies in relation to justice and also to the cabinet secretary dealing with the drug death emergency, because I think this flies in the face of public health approaches to management, particularly given there's no evidence that illicit substances have been responsible for any deaths in prisons in Scotland. Actually, the primary driver is prescribed medications. So I think there needs to be a greater effort to understand the nature of the problem rather than jumping the gun, particularly given the Scottish Prison Service's problematic issue with deaths in custody at the hands of prison officers.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Sweeney. Mr. Kidd.
Thank you very much, convener. I believe that we do have to take this further. I would like the justice of the evidence which has been put in front of us in terms of a failure to enact this this legislation in a proper manner. I am very concerned to read about psychoactive substances arriving in different formats for prisoners from outside. However, prisoners do have human rights, and I do not believe that all of their communications from loved ones outside should be treated in the manner which is being suggested. And I think this requires further investigation. And I do take on board the points from the SCCJR. At the same time, I think that we need to be able to see from proper investigation through Scottish Government what the actual circumstances are. I don't think we've been given that opportunity, and I think it needs to be looked at.
Okay. Thank you for that. There's a number of points there, and so certainly thank you, colleagues, for your thoughts and comments. So with that, so firstly, does the committee wish to report that it is not content with the explanation provided by the Scottish Government for breach of the requirement in Section 282-2010 Act, and emphasise, as the committee has done in the past, that the Scottish Government should normally comply with line requirements, facilitate timely parliamentary scrutiny of such important policy choices? Secondly, does the committee agree to highlight the correspondence received from the Scottish Centre for Crime and Justice Research to the lead committee? Finally, does the committee wish to highlight concerns about the speed of change in policy? Cabinet Secretary for Justice, responsible for prison reform and prison policy, and also the Minister for Drugs Policy. No members indicated that they are not content or that they wish to speak, and so are we agreed? Sorry, Graeme Simpson.
Yeah, sorry, convener. I think it's important. You may have covered this a moment. That we write a quite strongly worded letter to the government and to the relevant minister, just reflecting the committee's thoughts on this. I think that's important. Yes, we'll report to the lead committee. That's entirely right. But we need to get off what has been said just now down on paper to the government.
No, Mr. Simpson, certainly the final point I was raising there regarding the writing to the Cabinet Secretary for Justice will certainly incorporate the thoughts. Okay, under agenda item number 6, we're considering instruments not subject to any parliamentary procedure. No points have been raised on SSIs 2021-434-444-449. Is the committee content with these? No members has indicated that they are not content or that they wish to speak, so we are agreed. And with that, I'll move the committee into private.